number of announcements. First, the flowers on the altar are sponsored in loving memory of Val Pope on his birthday, October 28th, by his wife Sharon and the family, and flowers in front of the altar and in the back are in memory of Earl Wensler, whose funeral service was held this past Friday. So we keep them in our prayers. You will notice that we have a number of things going on. Reading glasses are needed as an announcement. There's a confirmation with confirmands, parents, and mentors meeting at 5 o'clock today in the youth lounge, and youth group goes on after that. And First Friday Family Night is going to take place on November 3rd, which is Friday night. The Mayor's Prayer Breakfast is going to be coming up on November 11th. Sandy Boothner has tickets for that event if you are interested. Sandy, and Sandy will be standing in the back of the church after worship, okay? So she would be happy to take care of that for you. Brunchen for Mission is in 2 weeks from today. Bell ringers and angels are needed for the Christmas season, which is coming very rapidly. And in 2 weeks, we are going to be commemorating Veterans Day during our time of worship. We have an announcement by Susie Hammond and Skip Petrosky is going to share with us a moment of concern.
Time and talent for one's own pleasures. While not denying the need gift. And while rejoicing in the gifts of life, we recognize that one of the most important acts in life is the deeply symbolic act of placing something in the offering plate. This shows a commitment to the welfare of all. The invitation to accept a new yoke, the yoke of Jesus, is a binding to reject the old ways of accumulating that are life-denying, and instead to embrace ways that are life-giving. As it pertains to stewardship, the old ways are exhausting and ill-fitting. The more we have, the more we want, and seldom do we have. By contrast, life in our community that is centered on Jesus as a charity to the world, that creates positive, life-affirming, purpose-driven energy that is easy and a good fit for those who try it as a discipline for their day-to-day life. Investing time, talent, money, and other resources in the values and practices of the church help to enact qualities of the church in the present, and thereby helps to keep alive for future generations possibilities that things can be different in a good way. Please remember the blessings that Christ has offered to you when you consider the blessings which you wish to offer to others through your giving to the church and others through the outreaches here at St. Mark's. Thank you.
Let us center ourselves and prepare ourselves for worship with
Thank you.
the door of the church at Wittenberg, Germany, and it launched the Protestant Reformation. The prayer, the opening prayer we pray today, is one of the prayers of Martin Luther. I invite everyone to pray together. Behold, Lord, an empty vessel that needs to be filled. My Lord, fill it.
I am weak in faith. Strengthen thou me. I am cold in love. Warm me and make me fervent. That my love may go out to my neighbor. I do not have a strong and firm faith. At times I have, and am unable to trust in you altogether. O Lord, help me. Strengthen my faith and trust in me.
Thank you.
forward and bring his parents and godparents with. They were bringing children to Jesus that Jesus might touch them, and the disciples rebuked them. But when Jesus saw, he was indignant and said to them, "But the little children come to me, do not hinder them, for such belongs the realm of God. Truly I say to you, whoever does not receive the realm of God like a child shall not enter." And Jesus took them in his arms and blessed them. Baptism is the sacrament through which we are united to Jesus Christ and given part in Christ's ministry of reconciliation. Baptism is the visible sign of an invisible event, the reconciliation of people to God. In baptism, God works in the power of forgiveness, the renewal of the Spirit, and the knowledge of the call to be God's people. As parents of this child, do you desire to have your child baptized into the faith and family of Jesus Christ? If so, please say we do. We encourage the child to renounce the powers of evil and to receive freedom from a new life in Christ. So please say we will. We teach this child that if he begins to confess Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, please respond, "We will, with the help of God." You promise by the grace of God to yourselves be disciples of Christ and to follow in the way of our Savior. Please respond, "We do, with the help of God." And as parents, do you promise according to the grace given you to grow in this child in the Christian faith? Please respond, "We do, with the help of God." And as this child's godparents, do you promise according to the grace given you to grow in this child in the Christian faith? We do, with the help of God. And as parents and godparents coming together, you promise to grow in your own faith as Christians. We promise with the help of God. Let us as a congregation express our support. We receive this child as a new person in Christ.
We offer our understanding and support as he explores life. We enfold him in our love, seeking together to grow in wisdom.
to introduce Oliver Walter Coomer with his parents and godparents. I believe that applies this day.
Bye.
you a lesson today, all right? And it's about grace, God's grace. But, oh, I need to invite all the rest of the children to the Lord. Yeah, I'm sorry. Now, I need you, but you're going to have to earn this.
Thank you. those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be silenced, and the whole world may be held accountable to God. For no human being will be justified in his sight by deeds prescribed by the law. For through the law comes the knowledge of sin. But now, apart from the law, the righteousness of God has been disclosed, and it is attested by the law and the prophets, the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. For there is no distinction, since all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. They are now justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a sacrifice of atonement by his blood, effective through faith. Now he did this to show his righteousness, because of his divine forbearance he had passed over the sins previously committed. It was to prove at the present time that he himself is righteous, and that he justifies the one who has faith in Jesus. Then what becomes of boasting? It is excluded. By what law? By that of works? No, but by the law of faith. For we hold that a person is justified by faith apart from works prescribed by the law. The word of the Lord.
Into existence of what we now call the Roman Catholic Church. There were people before that in leadership positions, but nothing that would be recognizable to anyone today. The New Testament, all 27 books of the New Testament, was not finalized until the year 397. And early in the 4th century, they began to build the first St. Peter's in Rome. And the Roman Catholic Church really didn't become a highly structured organization until around 500 AD. It took a long time for this religion to come into any sort of structure. About 500 years after it came into existence, there was a major schism within the church. We who live in the West don't always recognize that things happened east of Rome. And in 1054, there was something called the Great Schism, when Eastern churches and Western churches split, and these became known as the Orthodox churches, over many of the same issues that Martin Luther would have 500 years later. Yet, from 1378 to 1417, there was yet another schism within the church where three men all simultaneously proclaimed to be Pope. And so there were three Catholic churches going around. So when 1517 rolled around and the Protestant Reformation took place, the church had been already divided multiple times, and the Catholic Church itself was in great debt. And the construction of the Sistine Chapel had begun, and the rebuilding of St. Peter's Basilica in Rome was also underway. So we hit 500 years after that. Here we are in the 21st century, and Christianity is all over the lot. And multiple churches all claim to be the one true church. And I keep thinking, if there are multiple churches saying there's one true church, and it means there's probably no one true church. Here's the good news about those of us in the United Church of Christ. We've never gone down that road. We see ourselves as one expression of Christianity among many. One lesson I'd like everybody to walk away with is that it's important that we be in God's way and be a people of faith. And it's not so much about theological purity and rightness. But it's recognizing that God's church is inspired by God, because I really think it is, because if it was just up to us, we would have destroyed it a long time ago. But it's also always has been and always will be something of a mess, because we Christians are always managing to disagree with each other. And that's sort of the way it goes. The second thing is this. There's always been a battle in Christianity between law and grace. I do a Bible study at Westminster Nursing Home every month, and we read and discuss lectionary passages for the coming week. The lectionary being a common set of readings that all the different denominations use. And last month, a discussion came up about law and grace. And the discussion was, who should be welcomed in the church or not? Under what circumstances should churches have people in them? And one person said it, churches should have standards. And then they asked me, what are your church's standards? And somebody said, yeah, who is not welcome? And I thought, well, I thought about it for a while, and I said, I can't think of anybody who's not welcome. Well, there was the one guy who threatened to shoot me. And we said he couldn't come, which I was grateful for. But I said, other than that, everybody is welcome. And finally, one woman looked at me and said, doesn't your church have any standards? And I said, well, I guess not. And then I said, well, actually it does. It has one standard. The standard is this. Everyone who comes to our church is imperfect and sins, which means we welcome everyone because everybody is imperfect and sins. She said, that sounds like a very low standard. I said, well, I think it's God's standard. Christianity has always been stuck between law and grace. And the problem with law is it's always setting somebody up. It's always finding a way to leave people out. And grace is recognizing that we all fall short and need God to pick us up. The passage from Romans today is a critical passage that will help launch the Reformation. Martin Luther was a monk, and he also saw himself as a grave sinner. And he joined a group of monks that do not exist any longer, because they were a group of people who were an offshoot of a group called the Augustinians. And they were so absorbed in the concept of law and the belief that you had to do severe punishment to yourself, and it became punishment almost to the point of masochism. Luther had bought into this because he was such a heinous sinner in his own mind. And he was really brutal to himself because he did not live up to the law. And then he read this passage from Romans and he realized it wasn't about the law. It was about grace. And so he writes to the Romans and says it has to be about Luther, in reading Paul, reads Paul saying it has to be about grace. Paul was such a pessimist about human nature, he was actually an optimist. He believed that no matter how hard we tried, no matter how hard we attempted to adhere to the law, no matter how hard we tried to live up to the rules, we'd always fall short. Someone would always ask a question we could not answer. He said it has to be about grace. And as people who are heirs of the Reformation, those has to be about grace. The thing is this, the last thing is this, it always has to be about Christ. The Christian church exists for one reason. It has always been about bringing us into a journey with Jesus Christ. Always. It's not about theological purity, it's about Christ. It's not about how we interpret the Bible, it's about Christ. It is not about which church we belong to, it is about Christ. It is not about who we vote for, it is about Christ. It is not about where we stand on social issues, it is about Christ. And sometimes it's that simple. In 1 Corinthians, Paul writes, if we do something without love, it is worthless. And that is the same thing that goes for living our lives as Christians. No matter what we do, no matter what we say, no matter how we do it, if we do it without putting Christ first, we are a little more than a belt tightening going nowhere. So today we commemorate 500 years of Reformation. The reality is it's 2,000 years of Reformation. Faith is always in a state of reformation and evolution. Our opening hymn and closing hymn today are examples of that. All Creatures of Our God and King was attributed to St. Francis of Assisi. If you've ever gone to Mount St. Francis, it is that St. Francis. In the 13th century, he was a radical reformer, but he remained in the Catholic Church. But he was every bit the radical reformer that Martin Luther was. Times were different. A Mighty Fortress Is Our God was Martin Luther's poetic rendition of Psalm 46, put to the melody of a popular German beer hall song in the era, so that people could easily sing it, and it became the anthem of the Protestant Reformation. Christianity is always in a state of transformation. It requires us always to retain the humility that none of us ever has the final word. None of us has ever had the final truth. It is always to seek and seek the grace of God and always to focus on Christ. Amen.
Thank you.
of our hymnal, and there's a song response, and it's number 742, which is going to be the basis of our prayer and our closing hymn. There are concerns. We continue to pray for Rich Shipley, Wendy Swisher's brother, Harvey Fisher's friend, Sandra Ayers, Denise Thompson, Mike Thompson, who's a former associate pastor of the church's wife. We continue to pray for the family of DJ Ramp. Her visitation is going to be next Monday from 4 to 6 in the chapel, and the service is going to be in the chapel next Tuesday. Mitzi Parr, we pray for her family. This is Dennis Parr's mother. Visitation today is from noon to 6 and after 11 on Monday at Craft on Charlestown Road. And the service for her is tomorrow at noon. Bill Gimble was in the hospital this past week, and we pray for him. Joyce, I would like to thank all of the Harvest Homecoming volunteers. A lot of people worked really hard. Harvest Homecoming was very successful and was really good. And so we thank all of the volunteers. We are joyful that for the baptism of Oliver this morning. And we had a couple really exciting things happen. The New Albany High School class and some White Central students made lunch in the soup kitchen yesterday and did a really super job. And also a group let us learn that May Girl is part of raised $168 yesterday and presented it to our soup kitchen. So that was great. And Dee took the youth group and they went to Danger Run and had a lock-in on Friday night. And there's a lot of really tired people. So we are joyful. So let us come together with God in prayer.
Thank you.
return to you, Holy One, that which you first provided to us. May our offering and gifts of time, talent, and treasure further your work here on earth. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Let us turn and commission each other. Let us go forth into the world in peace.
Be of good courage. Hold fast to that which is good. Render to no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help give the good. Honor all people. Love and serve the Lord. Rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit.
If there is any hymn in the universe that celebrates and commemorates the Reformation, it's hymn number 65. A mighty fortress is our God. Let us sing it with our hearts and minds.
Thank you.
God loves us always and is with us this day and always.